Hello, and thanks for joining us on The Front Page, the show from the Racing Post that takes you deeper into the biggest stories in racing. I'm your host, Racing Post editor Tom Kerr, and I'm delighted to be joined in the studio by two of our top reporters, Peter Scargill and James Stevens. Welcome, gents.
Morning.
We're going to start with a story which is causing temperatures to rise on both sides of the Irish Sea. It's the removal of saunas from racecourses. Jockeys are up in arms at the fact they can no longer use these racecourse facilities to help them make weight. They say that the removal of the saunas over the last few years now means that jockeys have to make weight using off-course saunas, sweatsuits or other techniques which they say it's unsafe and it's causing jockeys to be dehydrated for longer periods. Numerous jockeys have come out in an increasingly tense debate over the subject, and James Stevens is going to tell us more about the story and why it matters.
Yeah, so a really, really interesting topic because, as you say, it's one that's been going for a while. November 2021 was when it was announced that saunas were going to shut. That was after a long period of saunas being closed due to social distancing measures when racing returned from COVID. And I think the key element to it was less so about the actual use of the saunas, but the weight allowance they were given. So when the saunas were shut, they were given a £3 weight allowance, which was then essentially got rid of and replaced with a £2 rise. But the issue is that the whole situation hasn't resolved and that jockeys are unhappy that they haven't got this facility to essentially just knock a few pounds off just before racing. And one of the big issues that the jockeys have come out and said is it's causing them a bit of stress and anxiety because they're going to the race course and thinking, perhaps maybe I am just a little bit over. And before they had that sort of, it's not so much a luxury, but that central tool of their work where they knew the sauna was there just to take a couple of pounds off. Now they don't have it. It's a tricky situation as racing has a lot of issues because a lot of these saunas no longer exist. A lot of them have been transferred into other areas. Improvements of the weighing room, which the BHA promised they would make, for example, female jockey facilities. Mm. And the BHA have said that when they closed the saunas, it was about improving jockey health and safety. They don't want riders to be on race courses dehydrated, but the jockeys have come out and said that that's part and parcel of what's going on. So there's a big debate, not only about how that weight can be changed, but also whether this is something that's right or wrong.
So there's a really interesting quote from Jamie Hart, one of many jockeys who has come out and said that the saunas should not have been removed and should be returned. He said, I can't get my head around the suggestion that we don't want jockeys to be dehydrated. And he said, I'd say 90% of jockeys ride dehydrated. It's actually quite a startling figure.
Yeah, it is. And I think for a lot of people that aren't involved in racing, that would really surprise you because you imagine a sportsman is going out to compete at the highest level, fit and prime, and every sort of attribute they can look after themselves would be perfected. And that is interesting, but I think that it's something that racing has long had because weight is such a key part of jockey's life and it's a key part of riding. You know, we talk about weights all the time. It's a key part of a handicap system, the fact that some jockeys will go out and ride a low weight and then they'll ride a high weight. It changes within an hour what they'll give them to ride and, of course, the weights and all that sort of stuff. So it's a unique in terms of out of the sports. I think the really interesting thing about this situation is that when that change was made, the PGA agreed to it. They said at the time 88% were in favour of the removal of the saunas. Well, you dig a bit deeper and what other media outlets are reporting, we're saying, well, actually 14% of jockeys said yes. The 88% figure comes from when the COVID weight allowance was going to continue, which it hasn't, but it's sort of been replaced, and improvements which were going to be made to the weighing room, such as warm-up facilities, better sort of facilities in the weighing room, which at the time they said will bring all venues up to a defined minimum standard and a far more professional working environment, which, to be fair, doesn't sound very encouraging that that's something they've sort of agreed on. So the situation is interesting because the PGA, who are the body, the voice of the jockeys, have once again, a few months on from the whip, which we've just talked here, they've either not listened, they've either not spoken, or perhaps most worryingly at all, the BHA haven't listened.
Well, and there are definite echoes of the whip rules issues here. This same sort of sense that jockeys either felt they weren't consulted or some would say didn't participate in the consultation, and their representative body has signed them up to a set of proposals that later down the line the jockeys are up in arms about. and it's creating a repeating picture of the same thing happening again. It's causing, behind the scenes in racing, a great deal of consternation because the PGA's efficacy is being questioned. You know, where do we go from here?
Well, it's the difficult one to resolve because essentially, as I said, the race courses have come out and said, well, how can we just put saunas back? It's a complete, you know, these are really difficult things to find space for, to build again. I think it's really unlikely, to be honest, that saunas are going to be back. You know, there's only 12 spaces which aren't already redeveloped on race courses, which suggests that race courses have acted pretty quickly. The fact that they no longer need saunas, that's key space in race course buildings that they've used. I think the answer has to be the weights have to be looked at. The BHA have said that they are sort of looking and researching into the dehydration side of riding, and that they're looking at sort of elements of the sport which can, how jockeys' welfare can be with the weights. So that's going to be a key area. But I think what needs to happen is there probably needs to be a bit of urgency about the situation, because the jockeys have come out and said that it's their mental health, it's that strain, they've got the whip which jockeys have talked about, and that it's making life a bit more difficult for them. They're struggling because they're finding it difficult to adapt on the new rules and the pressure of what might happen. Essentially, in short, they need to find an answer pretty quickly because the jockeys are pretty unhappy.
Yeah. Pete, there's a question about liability here as well, because, you know, when I've spoken to people involved in the sport about this subject, what they've said is that, you know, we can't bring back saunas, because if we brought back saunas and someone was getting dehydrated, losing weight in a sauna, went out to ride, had a accident, the race course could be held liable because the sport has previously said this is not a safe thing to do.
Oh, that's contorting. Someone's been contorting themselves in a conversation with you. I mean, I don't get how this has become such an issue. I mean, saunas won't come back. Well, they for any of the number of the reasons we've discussed. People shouldn't be riding severely dehydrated. I mean, it affects your physical performance and your cognitive performance.
But how do you achieve that outcome that people want? Because if jockeys are saying 90% of them are riding dehydrated, you know, can that even be put down to the weights alone, or is it simply the fact that if you have a sport where you have a weight limit or a minimum weight you have to be, people are always going to push the boundaries of it?
That is, I mean, they're professional sports people. They're going to be pushing the boundaries. There's no doubt about that. There was a study by Wilson in 2014 that talked about the effects of dehydration and jockeys, you know, their fitness and their health and their diet. And a lot of it talks about how they weren't applying the right sort of methods in terms of their fitness and their diet and what have you. That was updated in 2021. And they've compared to lightweight rowers and boxers and stuff like that. I think there's probably elements of this where you've got to look to an alternative. I mean, it's all well and good coming out and saying, oh, you know, we've always had saunas, we need to get them back, you know, we can't operate properly. But it just seems degenerative, that's not the right word, but, you know, it's can't be the right way to think. Well, you know, we've got to go back to sweating to make things work. There's got to be a different way of doing this, because it's not an effective way for a sports person to be operating.
And there have been huge strides, we should say this, in jockeys' nutrition, standards of fitness,
for sure.
What alternative is there? This is what I wonder about here, because I completely agree with you. Like, saunas aren't coming back. No. You know, doesn't matter. Every jockey could stand up and take, but they will not come back.
As well.
But
why is it so late?
Then what is the solution? Because I also completely agree with jockeys when they say, well, it's not right that as a consequence of this, people are driving to the races in sweatsuits, or they're going to hotels or off-site and using their saunas and dehydrate for longer. Like, clearly that is a bad outcome. Mm. And in some ways is a worse outcome than having saunas on the race course. But the saunas aren't coming back, and that is not an acceptable situation. So, you know, is there a way forward, or is this just an impossible circle to square?
Well, it can't be impossible, because no, there's always a way around a problem, isn't there? There's always a way around a problem. My mother told me there's always a way around a problem, and I work by that mantra.
Okay.
So, I mean, is it a case of, you know, do we need to look at the way that jockeys are building their muscle and, you know, their fitness in that sense? Do they need a lower baseline level of body fat for something like that? I mean, I think the study said jockeys have sort of a 15% level of body fat. that might be, say, it's an old enough study, it might be different now. Does there need to be different ways of hydrating themselves during the day? Do they need to look at the way that the weights are, the weights are framed?
It's an option, isn't it? It's a short-term option.
It's no good. I mean, as we've seen with the whip, it's no good having a body of people within the sport who are clearly put out by what's going on. But equally, coming out and shouting and saying, we want saunas back, it's quite typical of how things have been with the jockeys over the last few years. Yeah. Something happens, and then down the line, they say, oh, no, we didn't like it like that. And you half wonder whether part of what's going on now is because the jockeys have perhaps been more assertive after the, you know, not particularly good period they've had over the 18 months in their leadership. Mm. Are they now saying, well, we've got to be more vocal about these things. We've got to make our points because we're losing all of our battles at the moment. So I would say that coming out and shouting and saying we want saunas back isn't going to work. They need to engage more proactively to try and find a proper solution. And there's good people at the BHA and the PGA that could sort this out. Yeah. And clearly the jockeys want their voices heard. So I don't really see the benefit of this we want saunas back conversation. I genuinely don't see the point of it because it's not going to come back, is it?
We better leave it there because we've got a lot more to get through. Just before we move on to the next story, we've got a very special deal on our Members Club Ultimate subscription, $9.99 for the first 2 months. Check it out here.
Are you ready to take your passion for horse racing to the next level? With Racing Post Members Club, you gain exclusive access to the best racing insights, analysis, and tools. Immerse yourself in award-winning content, from interviews with the sport's biggest stars to race previews and behind-the-scenes features. Get the inside track with early access to the Racing Post digital newspaper from 9 p.m. in the evening and daily selections from our expert tipsters. Racing Post Members Club is your ultimate ticket to the thrilling world of racing. Subscribe today and pay just £9.99 per month for the first 2 months with the code SUMMER. See the link in the video description for more information. Terms apply.
Welcome back. The Shergar Cup, it has its fair share of detractors, I think that's fair to say, but it's also incredibly popular with the public. Saturday's team event, won by the ladies' team for the fourth time in 8 years, had an audience, a paying audience of 25,000 people at Ascot. That's 8,000 more than the fixture got the previous year and 7,000 more than the King George card just a few weeks ago recorded, albeit there was a train strike on that day. And at a time when racing is struggling with its public attendance, is it the case that, in fact, things like the Shergar Cup are what the sport needs more of rather than less, as some would argue? Pete, where do we stand on the Shergar Cup?
Well, I don't want more Shergar Cups. I think the Shergar Cup, it's been going for nearly 25 years now, which is worth considering. And it's, I don't know, it seems to have found its place, isn't it? It works. It's in the middle of the summer holidays. We're in this quiet period between Goodwood and York in terms of the level of racing. You know, we haven't got the big group ones and the starter names at this point, have we? So it slots in there. The team dynamics with the girls in particular seems to attract people in, and they want to cheer. So I think most of them probably cheer for the girls' team or the horse they bet. I'm not sure there's many cheering for Team Europe and what have you. But still, I mean, it seems to work. The crowds come in. People seem to have a good time. You know, it works as a one-off day. And I think that's as far as it goes, really. I mean, it's encouraging to see that the crowds are in. You know, people are drawn to coming racing, aren't they? I mean, that's a good thing.
Yeah,
that's
a good thing. One of Ascot's biggest days of the year. Mm. You know, outside the royal meeting, it's as big as it gets here. It's a huge success for them, in fact, isn't it? You know, when it's you know, consistently drawing a crowd comparable, greater than the midsummer highlight of the King George. You know, that tells its own story.
It surely does. And, you know, you tend to have the same people supporting it in terms of the riders and the trainers and the owners to some extent. They get good prize money. Yeah, I mean, I don't think there needs to be one at Thirsk and one at Redcar and, you know, one every week or anything like that.
Well, maybe there should be, but one, I mean, you think about how many fixtures there are per year in Britain, you know, we have one meeting which is kind of a sort of major, big budget novelty event, you might say, and it draws one of the biggest attendances of the year. I was a really fascinating interview with the Racing Victoria chief executive, which we covered in the Racing Post last week, and he was basically talking about, you know, the need for the sport to remain relevant, to reach new audiences. He's talking that there are sort of rumours, unconfirmed reports, I believe at this stage, still unconfirmed, that the Racing Victoria, who of course run the Melbourne Cup, are looking at doing their own team-based series, and some of the sort of novelties, gimmicks, whatever you want to call it, in that include potentially sort of miking up the jockeys so that they can speak to the team leaders or trainers during the race, aping Formula One. You know, fair to say the response to that has not been sort of universally positive. Are these things not good, James? Like, do we not need innovation in the sport, and should we not welcome it when it happens, bearing in mind that 99% of the sport remains in its sort of traditional format?
I think definitely these are the sort of things we should embrace, and I think if it does happen in Australia, British Racing can sort of sit back and watch how that goes down with their public. I mean, the other thing to remember is that we now live in a really big age where that sort of insider look at sport is huge. You look at any sort of sports documentaries, the amount of times where you're literally watching the manager inside the dressing room giving a speech, and the desire for that sort of content is really, really big. You mentioned Formula One, and that's a sport that's boomed, possibly perhaps the fact that you can feel so close to the action. You know, you're literally hearing what they're saying. So there's every chance that could really be successful. I mean, personally, I think it'd be brilliant, especially some of those big races. I love the jockey cam. I think it's such a really exciting way of showing a race and just looking at it a different perspective. And I always would like to see more jockeys, actually, rather than just went on the way back sort of talking about the race, sit down and talk through why did I go here, especially in the flat racing where it's quick second decision, those big sprints. If a jockey can really talk about the tactics of it and the inside sort of look at why I did this and maybe why I should have done that, I think any chance you get to really get in the mind of someone, just sometimes as we do with Mark Prescott on Sunday in the paper and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Anytime you really
or Ruby Walsh's analysis. Like, you know, it's definitely a trend in sports coverage over the last sort of 5-10 years is that what people value seems to be something which they cannot see with their own eyes while watching it. They want that level of insight, whether it's from experts or from participants. They want that behind the scenes access. They want to know what's happening that they previously could not see. And, you know, I don't know if miking up jockeys is the answer to that. Apparently it did happen once before. And basically what they got was completely unpublishable because it was just someone swearing for about 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Which you can imagine is largely what you're going to get in races.
To be fair, Tom, I remember quite early on in COVID where we went to a lot of meetings and there was nobody there. So you did hear a lot of the jockeys and a lot of that would be unusual.
I used to go to Queen's Park games in Glasgow where they played at Hampden, about 500 fans in there, and there's some very agricultural language used and directed at the players, to be honest. But that's actually what people kind of want, you know. They love to have that level of access, and, you know, notwithstanding that, you know, maybe miking up jockeys isn't the best way of providing it, it's an idea with some legs. We ought to be considering these things, Pete.
I don't think it's right to just dismiss things. I mean, you don't want people get quite defensive about racing because a lot of us came in through, you know, a love of a horse. You know, you're running your People's Champion Series at the moment. You know, a lot of people are being drawn in by watching Corto Star or See the Stars or whatever, a horse that doesn't have star in its name that I can't think of. And, you know, I'm going to the races, having that experience. And they, you know, they kind of want people to come in that way. That's the proper way to come in. That's the authentic way to come in. And they don't want to see it cheap, and they don't want to see it to be like the 100 where, you know, you're changing the number of balls and it's this and that. And that I think that's what puts people off. And they don't. There's elements that they don't like. You know, I like it because, you know, they're saying I like it because it's a race and I get to see this champion horse. They don't like the idea of a league or a team. And you know, this is some of the problems that the racing league has had, that people don't like the ideas of there being a league and all that sort of stuff. But to be fair, I mean, the racing league is trundling along. It's, you know, it's putting good prize money up. It's probably arguably spurred on some of the things at the Shergar Cup as well, because the Shergar Cup have had to up their game a bit. Mm. You could argue that Racing League coming along and putting up good prize money for similar sort of horses might have helped in that sense. And you have people like Safi Osborne, who shone at the weekend. You know, she got a... So I mean, it's such a small part of the sport, relatively. It's worth using it as somewhere to explore and have a look and see what might work. But it's not going to change the classics and all of that sort of stuff. And look, I don't particularly enjoy watching the Shergar Cup or the Racing League, but I don't have to. Do you know what I mean? You don't have to. No one's. But if you're vaguely interested, you know, and you know who Holly Doyle is, or you want to cheer on the girls' team, or you know,
and if it brings people into the sport, crucially, if
you may get to wear a cap or something afterwards. I'm not. You know, it's got its. There's no, but people like merch.
You can wear a cap anytime.
No, but people like merch. If I gave you a free cap for Team Scargill, which I've got outside, if you'd like one.
I've already got several, Pete. You might.
You'd be sporting that around London later on today. So I'm saying there's scope for having a go at things. It doesn't mean we all have to jump in and say this is great. This is the best thing that's ever happened. I think this is really good. But equally, you know, there is some room to explore things. And I think the Shergar Cup, 25 years on. Is showing that you can make it work and you can draw people in if you listen and you change and you adapt.
James, very last word on this to the Racing League, because it's obviously in its third year. We've had the first two meetings of this year's league. They've not managed to fill the races, which has been a bit of a shock, because Racing League's had its problems over the years, but it's always had very strong field sizes because it boasts very good, strong prize money. What's going on?
Well, I think that the formation of the teams, whereby there's one Newmarket team, which a lot of horses train in Newmarket, and they're restricted to only being in one certain team, really, unless they choose to compete for other teams. I think that's probably the key element. Perhaps it's the fact that there are so many. You know, there are decent opportunities for prize money at decent Saturdays. Some of the races at Ascot are worth a lot of money, for instance. So there's a lot of racing and field sizes generally. Don't always do great. I mean, I think my overall opinion on the Racing League is I felt a little bit disappointed watching on Saturday, because it was at Chepstow. It was Chepstow's biggest flat meeting for an awfully long time. I know they had a listed race there years and years ago. The crowd wasn't great, and it's a shame because, you know, Welsh people, I watch a lot of Welsh sport, they love to get behind Wales, and the fact that the team was Wales and the West and it was sort of all a bit clubbed together, and it's hard to build that association. You know, if it was just Wales on its own, and they might have only had two runners, but it was just Wales, maybe perhaps people would have really got behind that and the thought that, you know, let's support our country here. And it's difficult to get national pride into racing. I don't think we really see it until, you know, later in the season we've got British horse in the Breeders' Cup and things like that. So it's something that needs to be explored. But I think the concept, it's definitely got legs. It just needs to just fine-tune it. And as you say, it's only 3 years old, so maybe it'll improve. But yeah, the crowd wasn't great at Chepstow on Saturday as well, I'm told. But yeah, thank God the meeting finished, because it was a bit chaotic as well.
Certainly was. That's a perfect segue into racing's favourite team competition, which is Team Europe versus Team America at the Breeders' Cup. And if you would like to be there this year, you could have the chance of doing that with this fantastic competition from the Racing Post. Welcome back. As our final story this week, we're going to be looking at the best of the racing action from the weekend. And we're going to be starting at the Curragh, where the rising power of Amo Racing had its first Group 1. Here to tell us about that and its significance, Peter Scargill.
Yeah, big moment. A big moment for Kia Drebchen and his operation. So 2020-ish was when Kia, who's obviously the football agent, sports investor, really kicked on and started investing properly in racing. He'd been involved previously as an owner. And they've been building and building and getting momentum behind them, and more horses, and you see them more frequently and what have you. And they've had big runners, and they've had seconds in derbies and Gold Cups at Ascot and what have you. But they'd never breach that gap to go into Group One. And it's a big moment for any operation to get its moment in the spotlight with a two-year-old as well. Two-year-old who's proving to be quite talented in the horse whose name I can't pronounce, the horse trained by Adrian Murray.
Bocanero Fuerte.
That one, yeah. So, you know, it shows that they're able to not just have fast two-year-olds that come out, which is what people still probably associate with them, despite the likes of King of Steel. But, you know, they've got horses who can compete at the big level. So, you know, it's an operation that's pretty sizable now, despite the suggestions they're only small players.
Mm. Can you give us a sense of just how big they are in terms of numbers, what they've spent, how many they've got in training?
Sure. So in terms of, they've centralised their operation in the UK, in Europe, and in America. So they've got a few horses in Ireland, but it's almost a legacy thing to some extent. I mean, Robson Aguirre, who's part of the team at Adrian Murray's, is a key lieutenant within Amo Racing. So you know, that's the connection there, and that's where, you know, the likes of Valiant Force and what have you have worked in that sense. So they've got about 10, 15 horses in Ireland, from what I can tell. They've got probably about 100 over here, and, you know, you're looking at least another 20, 30 foot. So, I mean, you're probably saying comfortably 150 horses. They've got a retained jockey in Kevin Stott. They've got a racing manager. They've got a whole host of trainers. They've got a stallion in Persian Force, and very possibly other stallions coming along with King of Steel and what have you. Brood mares they've bought and they're breeding from. So, I mean, it's a huge operation. They also, I believe, they lease the yard that Dominic French Davis trains out of, or certainly part of it anyway. So, you know, it's a sprawling enterprise that's only going and must be costing a huge amount of money. I mean, Amo's accounts from last year, which is obviously showing last year's spend, not this year's spend, because they went quite big at the sales last year. They lost £5.5 million last year. So, you know, it's a costly enterprise.
And they'd have expanded quite significantly.
Yeah, exactly. And I think they've won about £1.5 million in prize money over here this year. And obviously there'll be things like they've got the stallion rights and stuff to come down the line. But, you know, at the moment it's a huge, costly enterprise, albeit one that's succeeding, and one that Keir's funding out of his own pocket, seemingly.
And what do we know about Amo's ambitions and where Keir wants to get this operation to?
Well, it depends. Obviously, last year we had the emergence of Omnihorse, this virtual reality AI gaming, which I've played. Have you played Omnihorse yet?
I haven't played. I wasn't aware it was available to play yet.
Oh, I'll show you afterwards.
Excellent.
It's good fun.
Fantastic. So just for those who aren't following this story as closely as you, Pete, Omnihorse is Amo Racing, the Amo Racing associated NFT project, where people could buy these non-fungible tokens which were associated with Amo Racing horses. Mm-hmm. And I think there was talk about this potentially being a sort of $1 billion enterprise. Obviously then also has a metaverse element to it. I hope you're following. This is quite a complex one. It's got a metaverse element where you can also what can you do in the metaverse? What can you do in the Omni horse metaverse?
Well, you can race your horse. Seems though I don't have any NFTs. I don't have a King of Steel NFT. As far as I know, you can't trade any Omni horse
and you cannot
NFTs
expense it, just to be clear.
But it's, yeah, you can sign up and you get a horse and you have the chance to sort of train it up. It's only a sort of testing stage at the moment. I still don't quite get what the objective is and how they benefit. But
early days, I guess. Yeah. You know, it is indicative, though, to the sort of sprawling ambition of Amo Racing. And I guess, James, racing's been quite fortunate in the sense that, you know, over the years there's always been a sort of steady stream of people willing to come into the sport, looking to invest in it, with a wide variety of outcomes. Sometimes they disappear after a few years, sometimes it all blows up, sometimes they go on to be hugely successful. But racing, if it didn't have these sort of big owners and ambitious individuals coming into the sport, would probably be in a bit of a pickle, frankly.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, any chance that racing gets for these big owners to come in and not just have horses with 1 yard but a few yards, it benefits the sport, doesn't it? And every we need these big owners to keep coming back, because it's good to have people across the industry. And I think Saturday, I mean, we were talking about his football agent, that felt like a big sort of away win. I sort of thought, you know, victory at the Bernabeu or something, you know, Aidan O'Brien's backyard, a race he was trying to win for an 18th time, and they've gone over and beaten him for so fantastic result. And I mean, I was looking through the top 2 year olds, and they've got two of the top tens, which suggests Fuerte and Valiant Force, which is pretty good. You know, they've got a good team going forward. King of Steel go to the Judmont International. He's a big flag bearer after that cracking run in the Derby and decent run in the King George. And it seems like they've got all the system in place to be a real force. And I always like to come in here with a stat, and I've got another really interesting one. So we talk in this game about big owners coming in and big forces and how it always continues to evolve. And top 152-year-olds on RPR, not a single one for John and Fady Gosden. They've not had a single winner on the turf this season from 17.
That is remarkable. They did, though, have a bit of success at the weekend. We should talk about this as well, because the Dettori retirement cruise moved on to Deauville. A fantastic training performance, you've got to say, to get Inspiral back just less than 2 weeks after flopping, and to win the big race at Deauville.
Yeah, 11 days on from seemingly finishing pretty poorly at soft ground and looked tired, really, of that sort of mid-race move to take on Paddington, who we think now is a real superstar. And that form possibly got an even bigger boost. A great performance. And I was watching the race after Tory seemed quite emotional. It was his last ride at Deauville. And yeah, it, you know, there's a lot of talk about his retirement and stuff, but we are sort of getting closer. And it's always nice to see him quite emotional after a race. And that was a cracking performance to get her back, because, as you say, 11 days on and she finished tired. So yeah, maybe you can't rule them out having a good end to the season anyway with her 2 year olds.
Maybe not. We better leave it there, because we've basically covered our allotted time. But it does leave me with the choice of what to put on the front page this week. I think the racing action that we had was strong, but let's be honest, we've got York coming up. This is not known as one of the strongest weeks of the year. Shergar Cup, the comment section would be interesting if we put the show of a cup on the front page. So we won't do that. It's got to be the racecourse saunas, doesn't it? It's a huge story. The jockeys are appalled by the situation. It speaks to the sort of broader issues around some of these stakeholder groups and how they communicate, and what feels like this growing sense of dissatisfaction
by the jockeys.
A real hot topic, exactly.
Not only am I beasting, I'm being like a terrible pun.
And on that note, we will wrap it up. Thanks so much for joining us once again. We'll be back next week with more analysis of the big stories in the sport. And of course, do subscribe to the Racing Post channel for all of our racing content. And if you've got any thoughts on today's show, then please comment below. We'd love to know what you think. We'll see you next week. And in the meantime, please download the Racing Post app.